Well, good morning, Lakeview Park. It is so good to be back with you guys. I feel like I haven't been here in forever. I miss you guys. Well, I'm going to read from Psalms 103, starting at verse 19. It says, "The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do word. Praise the Lord, the heavenly hosts, you, his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul." Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this awesome church, God, that we just get to come here and fellowship with one another, grow in our relationship with you. I just pray that you be with us this morning, that you speak to our souls, God, that we can take whatever we hear and go out and preach the word and just share with people what you put on our hearts this week. God, we love you, and we're so thankful for you. In your name I pray, amen. Well, if you're a guest with us this morning, we would love for you to let us know that. So there's a little connection card in front of you. Reach out in front of you. Pull that out. Put your name on it and put it in the offering plate as those go by. Again, we would love to know that you're a guest with us so we can just say thank you so much for being here. I have a few announcements. The first one, I'm on the wrong page. I apologize. The first one is the prayer meeting for Monday night starts back tomorrow. So if you're one of those praying people, make sure you're back on that on Zoom tomorrow night. Our kids are at camp right now, so we would just want to remember to pray for Alicia and all the kids that are at camp right now. I didn't know that was going to pop up. That was pretty cool, though. But all of our kids are at camp, so make sure you pray for them as they're at camp so they can grow in their relationship with Christ. We have a couple more Wednesday nights left for our summer classes. Who's been watching The Chosen? Anyone been watching The Chosen? It's pretty good. So we have that going on. We have a couple of different other classes, so make sure you get in those. On August 2nd, we will be redoing our classes, our Wednesday night classes, so you'll have a new selection to pick from starting on August 2nd. We have a lot of teen things coming up, so you can see those in your bulletin. Make sure if you're a parent, guardian of any student, teenager, make sure you look at those so they can get connected with us. Our most recent one that's coming up is Cheryl Curtis is having us at her house for a pool party. Super exciting. So that's going to be on July 30th. So we would love to have all your kids there. It's going to be a fun time. Well, those are all the announcements that I have. I hope you guys have a great Sunday morning, and let's worship the Lord together.
Let's stand, and let's sing these great hymns of our church.
The promise of God, the blood. Thank you. Of the church, and those are a couple of old ones that if you've been in the church for a while, you grew up singing those songs, and they hold such power, and they also hold a lot of our doctrine and theology, some of those old hymns do. So it's always a blessing when we go back and grab a couple of hymns. I'm going to ask Terry Edwards to come forward this morning. Terry, would you come up here for a minute? And Jodan, do you have the microphone? Let's give Terry. Terry, grab that mic from Jodan right there. I'm going to ask Terry to pray for our offering in just a moment. But some of you have taken your pictures next to these superheroes on the platform. How about taking your picture next to Terry? He has a Superman shirt on, and he has his superhero pants on, and I love it how the jacket just blends it all together. Isn't that great? Thank you, Terry, for decking out for Superhero Sunday. That is awesome. Well, we're not going to take the tithes and offerings yet because we have a few other things going on, but I do want you to go ahead and prepare. So get your checks ready or use the QR code on the back of the bulletin to give God his tithes that are rightfully his and then to give him offerings. But Terry, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and pray for our tithes and offerings that we'll receive in a few minutes, okay? Thank you.
Father, we thank you for this day you've given to us. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity this morning to bring back a portion of that which you have given to us. We thank you, God, this morning for the privilege it is to give to the kingdom of God and to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray now, Lord, open the windows of heaven as you promised and pour out upon us individually and collectively a blessing. Because you said, bring into thee the tithes of the storehouse, and I'll open the windows of heaven and pour out upon you a blessing. You won't be able to receive it. Lord, we're looking for that blessing that we cannot be able to receive full, overflowing. We pray, God, you bless Lakeview Park, its leadership, and all that you have plans for this church and for these people, your congregation, your loving children. Lord, we pray, bless us today. Draw us closer together. May we go away from the house of the Lord this morning saying it's been wonderful, great to be in the house of the Lord. God, we ask all these favors this morning, favors of you, in your sweet and holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Terry. Well, this morning we do want to remember a few other things in prayer, and we'll do that after a bit. But right now, we are so glad that our NYCers, our youth department, has come back safely from Tampa Bay, Florida, where they were apart with almost 10,000 other Nazarene students from around our nation in Nazarene Youth Congress. And so, Pastor Jodan, why don't you come and take over now? Oh, okay. Well, we're going to have that in just a moment. So hold on. I got a little confused. Carol Lee and Richard, could you put that photo back up of our children who are at camp? Let's pray for them in a moment, okay? And their sponsors, Mary Chestnut and Alicia Johnson, they have their hands full, don't they? That's quite a good group of girls they took to camp. They'll be coming back pretty soon. And then on Tuesday, Mary and Alicia will turn right around and go back with our older children, the junior campers. These are the primary campers. And Jim and Levina West are coming back today. They've been gone a month. They drove all the way to Alaska and with their family and camped all the way, and they're on their way back today, so they'll be with us next Sunday. We want to pray for traveling mercies for them. And also we want to remember to pray for Bonnie. As you know, she's on a little medical leave right now, and I got a text from her this morning. She only got about 10 minutes of sleep last night because of the pain, and so we want to keep her in our prayers this morning. So let's go ahead and go to prayer right now, and then we will go ahead and receive tithes and offering, and John Chestnut will bless us with our offertory. Father, thank you that Alicia and Mary are at camp safe with our primary campers. Jesus, I pray that you administer to each student there at camp as well as the sponsors, bring them back safely. And then, Lord, turn right around and do the same thing for our junior campers on Tuesday throughout the rest of the week. Lord, we praise you for bringing back Jordan and Lily and the students in our church who went to NYC. We are excited to hear their report in a moment. We ask that you continue to give Jim and Levina West traveling mercies as they are on their way back right now from Alaska, from being gone an entire month. And Jesus, we pray for Dan Scott and Janet and their family as they are leaving this morning to go to Oaxaca, Mexico to help out with vacation Bible schools. Lord, grant them favor in the villages where they will be. Bless their ministry. Explode the ministry there. And may many be one to your name through what you will do through them and also the nationals there in Oaxaca. Jesus, we also lift Bonnie Tolbert to you this morning. Lord, we ask that you would give her your healing touch. And Father, we ask that you would also provide your healing touch at the end of our service for others who would like to come forward for healing and anointing. But Father, go ahead and bless the tithe that we give to you that's rightfully yours, and bless the offerings that we give to you now in your name. Thank you, Father, for your faithfulness. Amen. Ushers, would you come forward? And after this, after John's offertory, then we're going to have Pastor Jordan and the teens present their report from Nazarene Youth Congress. Thank you. you, John. Before Pastor Jordan comes, how many brought your Bibles with you this morning? Even though we're talking about superheroes, we're also digging deep into the Word. Thank you for waving those. I hope you'll bring our youth department, raise your Bibles. Look at all those teens with their Bibles. I love it. I love it. So make sure you keep bringing your Bibles. Before you arrived today, your names were thrown into an imaginary hopper, and these names were drawn for a couple of superhero T-shirts. Amy Zimmerman, come on down. You're getting Captain America, my friend. And Josh Wheatley, come on forward. You are getting Batman. All right. Hey, it's good to be in the house of the Lord today, and we rejoice at the report that we will now hear from our youth group.
Chris's service, because we all carry around puddles that all, they're all troubles about us, and no matter how big the puddle is, God still loves us, and He all still cares for us.
Probably the most impactful thing was on the second day of the actual NYC part, the first speaker of the day, Chris, he had some disability, but he was still out there, and he was still preaching. He was talking about, we all have our puddles, and that really spoke to me. Like, if he could go up and do that, then I can do anything.
Something that I learned that I didn't expect to learn was that we can't allow ourselves to get in the way of helping other people because we feel like we're looking at
different. Something I didn't expect to learn is, like, obviously, like, water is important, but to really, like, put in perspective that water is, like, God is water, we need water to give us abundant life, and that's just a new perspective around that was really good for us, for the whole conference as well.
Thank you.
trip is probably like seeing everyone in praise together and how everyone lifts their hands together and lifts their hearts. It was really cool. And then some of the other moments, like it was a hotel room, everyone took it off. Seeing everyone kind of like happy and just out there, away from all the trouble of like where we live and come from, was really cool. It's good to get away and like learn more stuff.
I'm so excited to go to the Coke Factory. I just talked to my mom. She's letting me drink any soda I want. I used to dose up way more than I'm supposed to. I'm going to drink all the sodas. I've been waiting for this for 9 months. This is going to be the best thing. I had a great time over the whole trip, but I specifically enjoyed the Coke Factory. We had to try new flavors. My mom will be bold, so I've been so before, so I can try all the sugar flavors. That was pretty nice. So that was one of my favorite parts of the whole trip.
My favorite part was definitely talking to these people and like talking to them about where they were from and like how it was up there and how it works in my city.
All right. Well, as you can see, there was we had a very fun time. It was really busy, but it was a great time. I wouldn't trade it for the world. And so I'm going to have the kids come up as I kind of give my under 30-second report. I was super excited about NYC. I didn't get to go as a teenager in 2015, but I went in 2019 and I worked it, but it was a little different. But going as a sponsor was completely different. Getting to see these kids just pour their hearts out in these services, meeting people. It was awesome. It was such a cool experience. And so I wrote in my journal one of the days. I'm going to share it with you guys because I think it's great. And then I'll pass the mic down and they'll get to share a little bit. But I said, Nazarene Youth Conference is such a challenge to put in the words all that took place this past week. I went to service and I was served. I went to minister and I was ministered to. I went to give, but I received overflowing. I'm just thankful for the global work of the Church of the Nazarene. I'm grateful to have served alongside incredible pastors and leaders that are just doing faithful work. I'm humbled by the opportunity to be a part of something with internal impact. This isn't the church of tomorrow. These kids here isn't the church of tomorrow, but it's the church right now. Holiness unto the Lord, now and forever. And so I asked the kids to write down their answers so we're not up here forever. So I had them write them down so we can get through it. But the first question I had them write down was, what spiritual takeaways did you leave NYC with?
Kind of going back to the Chris thing, like just saying no matter, the trouble can't be little. It could be as little as it can. It could be as big as possible. But it's God. God will still help you get through it. That really stuck with me just through all that. So that was the one big takeaway I got from that.
A very big takeaway that I got from it is just, once again, just having this overflow of God's hope and God's love and wanting to just invite others to that and pour it out on other people. Marcus and Eduardo, you are more than welcome at this church because I love you guys and I want to overflow that love onto you guys.
Probably one of my spiritual takeaways is I started paying more attention to praise in the music and the words, so I got more of an understanding of meaning and emotion and what that means. And it's okay to be vulnerable when you're praising God, so don't be afraid to let your guard down.
My spiritual takeaway, it's kind of like specific in what a speaker said. He basically said that the Titanic is like a metaphor for spiritual life, meaning like on the upper deck, you know, there's joy and celebration and all that. But then after a couple of days, the ship hits an iceberg. And then now it's like the ship is like split into two. Now on the bottom, there's like chaos and all that. But on the top, there's still, you know, like joy. They don't know what's going on. Or maybe they do, but they just kind of ignore it. But basically, like, this metaphor is like a lot of us tend to live on the upper deck of our lives where it's happiness, and we kind of ignore that lower deck. And I really like that because sometimes I do it too. Like, I ignore my problems, and I just kind of live on that upper deck of my life. So that was a takeaway for me.
I'm not one of the kids, but I'll share too. So my biggest takeaway on the second day, our speaker was really focused on like living your life without clenching your fists and kind of just like letting go and like letting God. So that was really one of the biggest things for me, just kind of letting go of my control.
The second thing I had them answer was for them to just kind of summarize their trip from the day that we left all the way to the day that we got back. So they're going to share a little bit about that.
Overall, I had a really good time. Just meeting new people from all over the continent. The t-shirt trading was super fun. Some shirts got stolen, but it's okay. But I just had a good time. Just getting people's stories and finding stuff about people that you wouldn't expect to know is just like surprising. And it's also nice to be in such a huge room with all the people, so many people that believe in the same thing. It makes you feel like you're not alone, pretty much.
Kind of to elaborate off of what Jed said, like, it was just, it's kind of hard to put into words, but there's just something in your heart that feels different when you're in a place with 10,000 other people and everybody's singing and everybody's worshiping. It's just, it's a memory that, like, I will literally never forget, and I just can't wait to just share this love with other people and get other people into the church.
Like they've been saying, it was a great experience. There's really no place like Nazarene Youth Conference. But all places have God in them. Everywhere you go, he will never leave. He will always be there. And so we need to take what we learned from NYC and keep going with it. Like, if you're going all out at praise, don't stop there. Keep going. If you're starting to share word and comfort and, you know, help people through things, then don't stop there. Keep going. That's really what NYC taught me. It's like, let go and let love, but show life, show other people what life is meant to be.
Okay, my summary of the trip was, So I was like obviously excited to go, but at the same time I was really nervous too because I mean I'm the only girl. So I was nervous about that and like who I'm gonna share a hotel with, but I'm really happy that I like stepped out of my comfort zone and I went because I made a lot of friends that like to this day, like we still text and we still talk, and I've just made friendships and bonds with people that I honestly would have never like made if I didn't go to NYC. And also, hold up. Oh yeah, I also like learned a lot of new things that I wouldn't have learned if I didn't go to NYC. Like one that I really liked was, I think it was Lamoris that said it, he said you have to get off of Facebook and get in God's book, and I really liked that because that was nice.
So I had no idea what to expect with this trip. I didn't grow up going to church camp or like things like this, and so on the way there, we were on the bus for like 36 hours, I think, and then we were sunburnt after the beach, and it was hot, and it was like 115 degrees with like 80% humidity, so it was so easy to get bogged down in all of those like travel problems and all that. So once we got there, we were all just kind of like, okay, this will be fun. But after 3 days of like service and worship and this like everything, it was so it was so cool, and like it was a treat to really watch these kids come out of their shells and just grow in their relationship with God.
So I have a favorite memory that I'm going to talk about. As you can see, we all have different T-shirts on from Nazarene Youth Conference. So at NYC, they do a thing called T-shirt trading, and it's literally insane. So you have a bunch of kids with a bunch of NYC shirts from, I mean, there was people back from 2011 with T-shirts, and you trade them. And it's like a black market. Like you walk in, I think you saw the picture, but there's kids set up everywhere with all types of T-shirts, and you're trading them. And this is why we all have different T-shirts on, because we traded a few shirts. And Andrew and Judd tried to start a T-shirt trading business, but it didn't go too well. But it was super awesome. And so I think that was probably my favorite memory, just walking through and seeing all the kids straight T-shirts from, like I have a Kentucky shirt on. I've never even been to Kentucky. And so it's like, it's really cool. So it was awesome to see that. So again, I'm so thankful for you guys supporting our kids, going to NYC. If you guys can just give them a big round of applause. They did a great job. It was super awesome. So thank you guys so much. Yes, absolutely. One thing, we have to do two things first, and then we're going to hand it off to Susie, is we went to the Coca-Cola factory. And as you know, Susie loves Coca-Cola just like Judd does. So the kids and us, we got her a sweatshirt. You gotta open it up for her.
Wow.
So we got her a Coca-Cola sweatshirt.
No, thank you so much. Oh, my goodness.
Look at
goodness.
That. Yeah.
Wow.
So
I love that.
So the kids took their spending money and put it all together, and they got Susie a sweatshirt.
Thank
so that's super
guys.
Awesome.
So much.
All right.
Well, I wanted to come up real quickly and say I heard a rumor that someone received a call to ministry.
They did. And that's my next thing I wanted to talk about. Sammy over here. Sammy, step up. Sammy received a call to ministry. He told me that he was called to be a pastor. And so it's super awesome. So I've been here for a year and a half, and I've seen Sammy grow so much. And it was super awesome to hear him publicly say that, hey, I am called to be a pastor. It's super awesome. We were down on the floor talking to one of the NYC pastors, and the first thing he said was, well, you're loud enough to be called to be a pastor. So it was super awesome. But as Sammy has his call to ministry, it is our job to pour into him as much as you can to encourage this call and build him up. So be praying for him as he steps into this. He is young. You're going to be a sophomore in high school. So we have a few years left with him before we send him to college. But just really grow with him, encourage him, be with him as he has been called to be a pastor. So that's our NYC report. Thank you, guys.
Oh, that's exciting. And here's what I want you to be praying about. The next NYC is in 3 years. In 3 years, and it will be in Salt Lake City, Utah. Now, some of our students will be able to go again, and some who are not even in the youth group yet will be eligible by that time to be able to go. So let's be praying ahead of time for the Lord to lay it on the hearts of the teens that he wants from our church to go and to participate at NYC. Thank you for your support financially and spiritually that you have given those who went to NYC this year.
Summertime means superheroes, and we're taking a look at some of our favorites. Superman, Thor, Batman, Fantastic Four, X-Men, Iron Man, Captain America, and Spider-Man. Ready to draw the biblical parallels? Here we go.
All right, we are in a summer series that I'm calling Superheroes, Spiritual Truth from a Few Legends. Last Sunday, you remember, we talked about Superman, and this Sunday, we're talking about Thor. We're using the stories of these fictional comic book characters as modern-day parables that illustrate spiritual lessons. Now, in spite of his godlike power, Thor actually has a lot in common with you and me. In Marvel's 2011 film, Thor is portrayed as a brash, headstrong prince who inherited the throne from his father, Odin. He relishes adventure and he craves battle. Driven by selfishness and pride, Thor broke a truce between the Asgardians and their enemies, the brutal frost giants, and nearly started a war. Well, to teach his son a lesson in humility, Odin, Thor's father, strips Thor of his power and his mighty hammer and banishes him to a distant land, Earth. Let's watch.
And you thought your family had drama. No earthly family has had to contend with as much drama, conflict, and backstabbing, in one case literally, as Odin, Loki, Hela, Thor, and the rest of the Marvel Cinematic Universe's royal family of Asgard. So what did Thor Ragnarok reveal about why Odin stripped Thor of his powers in the first film? Let's take a look at a theory that brings the Asgardian story full circle. Before diving into the theory, let's first recap this mess of a family. Even gods have problems. First, you have Thor. Tall, strong, handsome, powerful, every inch the Prince of Asgard. He's also impulsive, arrogant, and thinks with his fists before engaging his brain. Just because he's a god doesn't mean he's perfect. His quick temper and love of combat cost him his home, his powers, and his enchanted hammer, Mjolnir. Then you have Loki. Sneaky, devious, scheming, conniving, and those are his good points. The god of mischief is always looking to take the throne and take down his adopted brother. Thor Ragnarok introduced audiences to Hela, Thor and Loki's older sister, who had helped her father conquer what would become Asgard, only to be banished when she sought to extend their conquests to the rest of the Nine Realms. And then there's the Big Daddy himself, the All-Father Odin. His efforts to keep the peace among the realms ended up splitting up his family into the biggest bunch of bickering brats since the Kardashians. Not exactly father of the year material. In 2011, Thor, Odin is about to retire and pass the throne on to his son. In the middle of the coronation, a band of frost giants invades Asgard, steals the casket of ancient winters, and escapes to the realm of Jotunheim. Thor leads a group of Asgardians to Jotunheim to take it back, defying Odin's orders. Thor and his friends mow down dozens of frost giants until Odin steps in and takes them back to Asgard. As punishment for his arrogance, Thor gets stripped of his title, his powers, and his hammer, and exiles him to Midgard, the realm we know as Earth. He struggles with life on Earth, falls in love with physicist Jane Foster, and tries to recover Mjolnir, only to learn that he is no longer worthy to carry the magic hammer. Only when he learns humility does he have his powers restored, allowing him to defeat the giant robot called the Destroyer.
Okay. Carol Lee, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and end that a little bit early. Going to end that a little bit early because we're running just a little bit behind here, and I want to hurry up and get this entire message to you this morning. He's humbled, and he's humiliated, Thor is, and he's in a distant land, the land that we know as Earth. Thor finally comes to his senses. He repents of his foolish ways, and he learns the value of selflessness. And in the end, Thor foils the evil plot of his jealous brother and is reunited with his father, who welcomes him home with open arms. Now, the story of Thor, even though it's fictional and fantastic, at its core is very similar to a story Jesus once told, a parable about a wayward son and his loving father. We call it the prodigal son. And it's a short story about a father's all-encompassing, incomprehensible love. And it illustrates the stages that we often go through in our relationship with God. And the first of those stages is rebellion. We've all rebelled and fallen short of the glory of God. And both Thor and the prodigal son rebelled against their fathers. Thor defied his father's orders and endangered the lives of everyone in Asgard. The prodigal son's rebellion was more subtle and probably even more hurtful. Let's look at how Jesus tells the story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, "I want my share of your estate now before you die." So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land and there wasted all his money in wild living. Now, I want you to know, in ancient times, the younger son would normally inherit about half as much as the firstborn son when their father died. It wasn't completely abnormal or out of the question or unheard of for a son to ask for his portion of the inheritance while his father was still alive, but it certainly wasn't very loving. It showed his arrogance and his disrespect for his father. It was as if he had said to his dad, "I wish you were already dead." Both Thor and the prodigal son grew up in their father's homes. They were showered with love. They had everything they needed, and they had a lavish inheritance awaiting them. But the prodigal son was just tired of it all. "I'm tired of living under my father's rules. I'm tired of doing what my father tells me to do." He wanted to be his own man, to do things his way. And it didn't matter who he hurt in the process. That's part of rebellion, isn't it? This story reminds me of a 5-year-old girl who was having one of those trouble-filled days with her mother. And they had spent the day just arguing back and forth. The mom had finally had enough. "Jenny, go sit in the corner now. And don't you get up until I tell you to." So Jenny went over to the corner and sat down. But within about 10 seconds, she was right back on her feet. And she was fooling around and messing around. And this time, her mom raised her voice a little and threatened her with a spanking. So little Jenny went to the corner and sat down again. And after a couple of minutes, her mom said, "Thank you, Jenny, for sitting down like I told you." Then the little girl called back, "Mom, I'm sitting down on the outside, but I'm still standing up on the inside." We all tend to have a standing on the inside nature, don't we? And the Bible calls it our sinful nature. And it means that we have this natural inclination to put ourselves first, to rebel not only against our parents, but even against our Heavenly Father. And I see this often in Christians, especially those who have grown up in conservative Christian homes, and they've attended conservative Christian churches like ours. And studies show that more than 50% of those teenagers who grow up in church-going households drop out of church shortly after high school graduation. I think probably all of us here would say, "Yeah, I know somebody who fits that bill." You see, as they come of age, they embrace a rebellious spirit. They don't want to live by God's rules anymore. They don't want to be a part of His house anymore. And many of them find themselves living in a distant land far away from their Father in heaven. And that's where both Thor and the prodigal son found themselves. But thankfully, that's where they both came to their senses. The second stage in our relationship and their relationship with their respective fathers was repentance. Far from home and away from the guidance and wisdom of his father, the prodigal son wasted all of his inheritance on wild living. Let's look at how Jesus continues the story. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. Now, my mom always told me when I was growing up, "Your bedroom, Susie, looks like a pigsty." Well, this boy's actually was one. He was living in a pigsty. And while he was feeding the hogs and while he was wallowing in the mud, this prodigal son was wallowing also in misery and self-loathing. And as he laid there surrounded by unclean animals, his mind kept drifting home to his father's house. And he said to himself, "All those farmhands working for my father sit down to 3 meals a day, and here I am starving to death." You see, this wealthy, starving teenager, knew his father would not go to sleep that night without having a full meal, but he wouldn't. So foodless and friendless, this prodigal son, this teenage boy, had hit rock bottom. And that's where the Bible says he finally came to his senses. Isn't that also true of us oftentimes? It's when we are flat on our back, or our back is at the end of the wall, or we're hanging onto the last knot of our rope. When we're flat on our back, we hit rock bottom, then we come to our senses. And he decided to go to his father and tell him, "I am no longer worthy of being called your son." Now, what's interesting to me is he started this whole scenario by saying to his father, "Give me!" And he ends it by saying, "Make me. Make me as your servant. Give me, make me." And that's where we want to be in our relationship with Christ. We start out as rebellious sinners. "Give me, and my way, and me first, and my will." And hopefully, as we progress, the Holy Spirit transforms our hearts, where we begin to pray, "Oh, Father, make me your own. Transform me in your image." And Thor came to the same realization in a dramatic scene from the film. Even after being cast out of Asgard, Thor was convinced that all he had to do was find his magical hammer, Mjolnir, and his power and glory would be restored to him. Unbeknownst to Thor, though, Odin, his father, had placed an enchantment on the hammer, whispering these words, "Whoever holds this hammer, if he be worthy, shall possess the power of Thor." After a hard, long search and a hard-fought battle, Thor finally finds his hammer in a shield facility. But as he wraps his fingers tightly around its handle, he discovers he can't lift it. His muscles strain and his teeth grind. But no matter how hard he tries, he can't budge the hammer. Let's take a quick look. He can't pick up the hammer because he's no longer worthy. When he could no longer yield his own hammer, Thor finally realized how unworthy he had become. And the truth is, we're all unworthy. Not one of us is worthy to be called a child of God. The Bible says there is no difference, for all have sinned, and all of us fall short of the glory of God. For many of us, it takes, again, hitting rock bottom to realize how truly wrong that we've been and how far we've fallen. But recognizing our faults and failures isn't enough if we don't do something about it. Let me repeat that. Recognizing our failures and our fault isn't enough if we don't actually do something about it. Now, you've probably all seen the old Peanuts cartoon strip with Lucy holding a football and inviting Charlie Brown to kick it. But Charlie Brown refused. He said, "Every time I try to kick the ball, you move it, Lucy, and I fall flat on my back." Suddenly, Lucy broke down in tears and confessed, "Charlie Brown, I have been so terrible to you over the years, picking up the football like that. I have played so many cruel tricks on you. But, Charlie Brown, I have seen the error of my ways. I've been so wrong. Won't you give a poor, penitent girl another chance?" Well, Charlie Brown was moved by her sincerity. So he said, "Of course, I'll give you another chance." She positioned the ball, and Charlie ran to kick it. But at the last moment, she picked up the ball. And Charlie Brown once again fell flat on his back, just like always. And Lucy's last words, "Recognizing your faults and actually changing your ways are two different things, Charlie Brown." And Lucy's right. The realization that we're not worthy, that we have made mistakes, and that we need forgiveness ought to drive us to get up and go back home to the Father, to run after our Father. And that's what repentance means. Repentance isn't just some made-up religious word. It actually comes from a culture where people were essentially nomadic, and they lived in a world with no maps and no street signs and no traffic lights. And it was easy to get lost walking through the desert. At some point, you become aware that the countryside is strange and you're not where you should be. And you finally say to yourself, "I'm going in the wrong direction." Then you turn and go a new way. That's repentance. And that's what both Thor and the prodigal son did. And as a result, they finally experienced restoration. And here's the happy ending to the master's storyteller's tale. So he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming, and filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. Now, as the wayfaring teen comes over the hillside, he catches his father's eye. He probably has no idea what awaits him. The best he can hope for is a cold shoulder, or maybe a disappointing lecture from his father, and maybe a smug, "I told you so," from his jealous brother. But when his father, who'd been watching the horizon for his son's return, sees him, he rushes to his long-lost son and throws his arms around him. And once this lost son was back in the arms of his loving father, that's when the party started. The father called for the finest robe in the house, put it on him, symbolizing his acceptance by the family. He was given a ring for his finger and new sandals for his feet. They killed the fatted calf, and the celebration began. Party! When the older son, who had been at home by his father's side all along, expressed his jealousy, the father wisely said this, "My son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead, and he's alive again. He was lost, but now he's found. Of course, the father in the story is a portrait, isn't he, of our loving heavenly Father, Jehovah God in heaven, who's just standing at the edge of eternity, watching and longing for his children, that's us, to come home to him. Scripture says this, all of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. Now, I want you to read these next two slides with me. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. And so when you're alone at night with just your thoughts, maybe you've wondered, could God really forgive me? I mean, I've blown it so much. Pastor Susie, I'm pretty sure I've thought some things, fantasized about some stuff, did some things that probably nobody else in this sanctuary has done. I mean, I've blown it, Pastor Susie, a lot. And so, yeah, at times I tend to think, well, could God really forgive me? Could it be that Jesus shared this story of the prodigal son to answer that question? No matter who you are, where you've been, or how far you've wandered, you have a Father in heaven who loves you, who longs to hold and embrace you in his arms, to forgive your mistakes and your sins, and to give you a home with him for all eternity. A woman once wrote Today's Christian Woman's Magazine. Now, that's not on the market anymore, but years ago, I used to get that magazine. Does that sound familiar to anyone, Today's Christian Woman? Years ago, this little story was in it. While putting my four-year-old daughter to bed one evening, I read her the story of the prodigal son. We discussed how the young son had taken his inheritance and left home and living it up until he had nothing left. Finally, when he couldn't even eat as well as pigs, he went home to his father, who welcomed him. When we finished the story, I asked my daughter what she had learned. After thinking a moment, she said, "Never leave home without your credit card." Well, that brings a smile to your face, but that's not the lesson Jesus intended for us to learn from this story. The parable of the prodigal son, along with the story of Thor, illustrates our own rebellious nature and our need for repentance, as well as the unrelenting love of our Father in heaven who longs for our return. Maybe you've asked God for forgiveness, but you've not yet repented. Pastor Susie, I thought they were the same thing. No, repentance means turning completely away from your sin. Confession is, will you forgive me? Repentance is, after that, turning completely away from your sin. Could it be that you're caught in a vicious cycle? Forgive me, Father. And he does. And then you just stay there in the same place in your sin. And you've never actually left it. God wants genuine repentance from you. It could be that you're wrestling with a rebellious spirit like Thor, or like the prodigal son. And I'm wondering if possibly you've been living in a distant land away from your heavenly Father. Being here this morning is the first step in your journey home. Our altar is open, and Jesus is here to wrap you in his arms and to help you complete that journey if you're ready. So this morning I want to ask you, will you run to the Father this morning? Would you do that? Would you run to the Father's embrace this morning? If you'd like to do that, then I invite you to come and meet Him at this altar of prayer. And I also want to extend the invitation this morning. If you want to pray for healing, you need a special physical touch from God today, then I'm going to ask you to come and just sit on the front row. But everyone else who wants to pray for yourself, or maybe you have a relative or a loved one who's in a distant land this morning, they're far from God, you want to come and represent them at the altar. Would you come as we sing together, as our praise team sings, "Run to the Father"? You come now.
No reason to wait.
Let's stand together. We serve a mighty God. Would you continue to pray for those who have come forward? Lori has come forward to represent Bonnie, and I have anointed her in place of Bonnie. She stood in for her. But also for Pilar, her body is in pain this morning. Would you pray for that? Estelene's eyes and her brother Paul, they need healing, her eyes and her brother. Janice is having tremendous pain in her back and is facing some complicated surgery ahead of her. Amy is having some kidney pain. And we also pray for her father, Dillard, from cancer. And Paul is experiencing some bad back pain. We lift all of these to you. And Jesus, Caroline is experiencing major problems in her sinus. It's difficult for her to even breathe. So, Father, would you touch all these now that we have anointed? We brought them before your throne. And Jesus, we're saying, here we are. We need a physical touch from you today. We know you're the great physician. Father, we know that you took a little clump of dirt and you made a human being out of it. We know that you called the stars into action and you set the whole world in motion. And Jesus, we know that complete healing is nothing at all to you. Father, we know you always heal. I believe that, Jesus. You are the great healer. You always heal. Sometimes it's on earth. Sometimes it's not until heaven, but you always heal. Jesus, we're asking, if it's your will, would you choose to heal today on earth? These who have come forward and are saying, I need your healing touch. Thank you, Father, for being our great physician. Jesus, now will you go with us this week? And as our teens so eloquently testified, help us to remember it's not about us living on the top of the Titanic, or it's not about us just seeing our needs, but it's us living in the center of your will. Thank you, Lord. May your face shine upon us. May we experience your blessings and your grace and your mercy and your strength this week. In your precious name we pray. Amen. You are so loved. Go and be a blessing to those around you.